begin with breaking news here at 5 o'clock. I-5 in Salem is closed right now because of police activity. This covers all lanes, both northbound and southbound, at the D Street overpass. Travelers are urged to avoid the area if they can and to expect delays. We will update you when it's clear.
I feel highly accountable for community safety. That's part of the reason I'm standing here today in front of the press, outlining the steps that we're taking now, outlining what we're going to be doing in the future.
It's a new plan in Portland to get a handle on shootings in the city. It has been one of the most violent years in Portland's history. Today, Portland Mayor Ted Wheeler laid out steps to try to make the Rose City a safer place to live. Devin Haskins has the details.
If it feels like the gun violence in Portland is hitting all-time highs, that's because it's heading in that direction. And when it felt like it couldn't get worse than 2020, in 9 months, 2021 has proven to be just as bad. More than 870 shootings so far. Last year, there were 891. There have been 62 homicides. That's more than last year, 46 of them by guns. Just this week, multiple shootings where more than 100 casings were recovered. Thursday, a 15-year-old was shot in the Madison area of Northeast Portland. Police say it was the teen's second time being a victim of gun violence. In that same shooting, an innocent adult was also hit. Some would argue the city doesn't put stopping gun violence as a priority. The mayor's reaction?
Yeah, it's disappointing.
In an hour-long press conference with reporters, he laid out the city's plan to combat violence. First, with the implementation of the Enhanced Community Safety Team, which allocates more investigative resources to shootings. Then, diverting $6 million of the police budget to community-based organizations. Part of that money has already been distributed. And creating a focused intervention team consisting of a dozen officers and two sergeants. The goal would be to get more guns off the street. The team will operate under a community oversight group, and the mayor says the unit should be fully staffed by November.
All of these things combined, I believe, will make a difference in reducing gun violence in our community, but it's not going to happen instantly.
The mayor and police chief also want to fund a rehire-retire initiative for the Bureau to quickly increase the number of active officers. There are currently 80 that are eligible to retire.
It's very easy to say, I want to reduce gun violence by 20% in 15 months. The hard part is actually deploying the strategies and the resources to make it happen. And that's where I'm focusing my attention and my energy.
The mayor also talked about increasing funding to 311, which would divert non-emergency calls away from 911 that are being sent to police and fire. He also said he'd like to see the street response team go citywide. In downtown Portland, I'm Devin Haskins, KGW News.
A big update today on the Pfizer COVID vaccine. An FDA advisory panel has voted against booster shots for most Americans. However, it did endorse boosters for people 65 and older, those at high risk of getting severely ill from COVID, or those with a high risk of COVID exposure at their jobs. The decision was made by a committee of outside experts who advise the Food and Drug Administration. Well, the Oregon health officials continue to warn against taking ivermectin to treat COVID after 5 people were hospitalized. Doctors, the FDA, and Merck, that's the manufacturer of the drug, all say this is not an effective or safe treatment against COVID. Ivermectin is a drug meant to treat parasites in people and some animals. Federal, state, and local health officials all say ivermectin does not work when treating COVID. Dr. Robert Hendrickson is the medical director at the Oregon Poison Center at OHSU.
Ivermectin is a medication that doesn't work for COVID. It doesn't prevent it. It doesn't treat it. And it can be risky to take it.
The Oregon Poison Center reports 25 cases of people intentionally misusing ivermectin to treat or prevent COVID since August 1st. 5 people had to be hospitalized. The patients had a variety of symptoms, from mental confusion to seizures.
One of the things that we've been seeing is a lot of people who are purchasing veterinary products or veterinary ivermectin to treat themselves. It's really difficult to get the right dose for a human from a veterinary product. And most of the cases we're talking about here are people who have done that. They've tried to get the right dose and made a mistake or just miscalculated And can get really, really sick. And we've even had people go to the ICU.
Dr. Hendrickson said while some early studies showed ivermectin may work to treat COVID, this was in a lab. When tested in the real world on people, ivermectin did not work.
I think there's a lot of interest in ivermectin. And some of the earlier studies were really exciting. And if you only read that early study, the cell studies and things like that, it's reasonable to make some sort of conclusion that ivermectin might work. But unfortunately, we've done bigger studies and studies that are really well designed, and it simply didn't work in any of those studies.
We also talked to Dr. Marcel Curlin about those early studies. He's an infectious disease specialist at OHSU.
The problem with ivermectin is those studies, those laboratory studies, use doses that are orders of magnitude higher than what you and I would get for a parasitic disease. So the problem is you run into toxicity.
Doctors say the best way to prevent COVID is to get vaccinated. There are some treatments working to help COVID patients, like monoclonal antibodies. That treatment was given emergency use authorization by the FDA and is being used by at least 30 hospitals to keep high-risk COVID patients out of the hospital. Ivermectin is not approved by the FDA as a treatment for COVID.
So my plea is to not use ivermectin. Get in touch with their primary healthcare provider. See if there's something that you qualify to take to get your symptoms better. But ivermectin is not worth it.
And some parents with kids in the Portland Public School District are growing frustrated with what they say is a lack of planning for distance learning. A couple hundred students are quarantined right now district-wide. That has parents asking what exactly would it take for an entire school to switch to distance learning, like we saw this week with Reynolds High School. That school was forced to quarantine thousands of students due to a few COVID cases.
It's inevitable. Kids are going to miss school. There's no vaccinations for the elementary level. I'll be shocked if they're going by, if they're still there by Halloween.
District and Multnomah County leaders say there's no single metric for when to shut down an entire school. Also, another issue, seating on buses. There's no assigned seating, and the Portland District is still working on coming up with seating charts. At Dunaway Elementary, a student riding the bus tested positive, and with no way to contact trace, 40 other students who also ride the bus had to quarantine. King County in Seattle is laying down strict new COVID vaccine rules. Starting October 25th, locals will have to prove they're vaccinated to enter most businesses. That includes indoor places like restaurants, bars, nightclubs, movie theaters, and show venues. Health officials say data modeling shows COVID cases will rise without vaccine verification.
The Delta variant has fundamentally changed the course of our COVID-19 outbreak and how we must respond to it. In the model's maximum effect scenario, vaccine verification could prevent up to 20% of infections, hospitalizations, and deaths.
Proof of vaccination includes your vaccine card, a photo of it, a certificate, or a vaccine record from a healthcare provider like a doctor or pharmacy. Washington is also working on an app that could make showing vaccine proof more streamlined and easier for everyone and businesses. That could be ready by the end of the month. All right, this is one of the more bizarre headlines you'll ever hear. A beaver is being blamed for starting a brush fire near Multnomah Falls last night. Fire crews say the beaver chewed through a tree, which then got blown over onto power lines, sparking the fire. It started south of I-84 near the Multnomah Falls exit. Crews, though, had it out in about 2 hours. All right, let's bring in chief meteorologist
Matt Spina. Smokey the Bear is going to have a big talk with that beaver.
Yes, you can't make this up.
No.
Yes, so what are we looking for this weekend? Any rain that may help firefighters and maybe some troublemaking beavers?
Yeah, well, I can't forecast that. Hopefully the Beavers get a win down in Corvallis as they take on the Idaho Vandals in football. But it is going to be wet there, and it is wet across western Washington. In fact, a lot of Washington right now. I think it's been a great day, Kristen. I don't know about you, but cloudy, warm, breezy. It just felt good. Felt like fall, even though, of course, it's still late summer. So you can see the rain to our north. It hasn't reached Oregon yet, unless you're in Astoria and Tillamook, which picked up a little bit. But look what's already happened on the coast of Washington. 1.39 inches up at Quileute and Forks. Yes, that's like the rain capital of the lower 48, right? But still, That's impressive. Hoquiam has had over half an inch. Even Olympia has had a quarter of an inch, so it's not that far away, the rain, and it is headed our way. In fact, it'll be a little bit later tonight, after about midnight, actually, is when the rain will begin. And it's a steady pickup all the way till about 4/10 of an inch of rain by 6-7 a.m. It may actually be a little bit more than that, and we're not done at that time. That's just the overnight hours. So I look for the rain to begin again after about midnight tonight, which is kind of great timing. We've got high school football going on tonight, so it should be dry for that. But when it starts going, it's really going to go in the valleys, 1 to 2 inches of rain by the time it's all said and done Sunday night, 2 to up to 5 inches in the mountains, the North Coast Range, North Cascades of Oregon, and the Southern Cascades of Washington. Again, beginning sometime after 10 p.m., but I think after midnight is probably more likely. And then heavy rain Saturday morning. That's our heaviest rainfall, but the strong showers continue all weekend long, Kristen. So this is the best news we could hope for in terms of wildfires started by beavers or otherwise. Back to you.
Yes, great news for wildfires. Thank you so much, Matt. Well, the first ever female police chief in Portland and the U.S. has passed away. Penny Harrington accomplished many firsts here in Portland, including the first female through the ranks at PPB. She fought to end discrimination in the bureau and championed many programs to promote diversity. As chief, she reduced burglary by 8% within 3 months of her appointment, reduced citizen complaints by 30% in 1 year, and developed programs to improve relationships with minority communities. She was 79 years old.